I pledge allegiance to the flag of Michigan and to the state for which it stands, two beautiful peninsulas united by a bridge of steel, where equal opportunity and justice to all is our ideal.
Sandy, could we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Shippers?
Here.
Spelman?
Here.
Stevens?
Here.
Keith?
Here.
Mayor Philpotts?
Here. Okay, the first thing we have on our agenda this evening is the approval of the agenda with two additions. One is with the addition of a special election update, and the other is to add a recommendation regarding alley construction as item C under the city manager's report.
And where are we putting the update?
We can do that as D.
D.
In the alley construction is the item we were emailed about?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I will make a motion to approve the agenda as amended.
Support.
Sandy, could we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Spelman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Mayor Philpotts?
Yes. Motion carries. At this time, we'll open the floor for public comment. If you would like to step up and speak, if you would let us know your name and then also write down your name and your address for the clerk, it would be very helpful.
Good evening, Madam Mayor and members of the council. My name is David Reiser, and I'm here to speak about a topic that I didn't know was going to be on the agenda, but it is, and that's the special election. I'm speaking in reference to the city charter, and I was the chair of the Charter Revision Commission that wrote this city charter that was adopted in 1979. And I'm very pleased with the way that the charter functioned when we had the unexpected vacancy of a member of the council. The council was required then within 30 days to make a selection of a qualified candidate, and good for the city of Cadillac, you had two good choices, and you made a great one, in my opinion, and I salute you for that. So the charter worked in that function. Additionally, there will be a special election scheduled for the next citywide election in the city, and that will be in March, the primary, presidential primary, and that's going to be paid for by the state of Michigan. So that saves us the expense of having our own special election. Now, I know that there are those who think that this is antiquated language in the charter, and I admit that it is, because we copied from the great charter of 1215, the Magna Carta. So that's why we get this, what you think is obsolete language. But I want to inform you that this charter was a matter of compromise. It was the fourth attempt to revise the city charter and present it to the electorate for its approval. I served on two of those charters commissions. So much of what in here is either by compromise, which is the normal political process, or by not changing too radically the elements of the charter that the people were comfortable with. So again, I salute you for your choice. I think it's a good choice. We'll find out in March if the people like your choice. They will put their imprimatur on it. If not, we'll throw the bum out and select someone else. In the meantime, Bill, I wish you well, and I thank you for your attention, and excuse me, I have to go home and write some FOIA requests. So thank you for your time.
Okay, seeing no one else, we'll go ahead and close public comment and move to the approval of the consent agenda. This evening, we have the minutes from the regular meeting that was held on November 16th, the minutes from the closed session that was held on November 16th, along with the minutes from the special meeting that was held on December 3rd.
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Support.
Sandy, could we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Stevens?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Spielman?
Yes.
Mayor Copeland?
Yes. Motion carries. And then that moves us to some communications for this evening.
Yes, the Historical Society is holding a fundraiser on New Year's Eve at the Elks Lodge. And they are requesting for approval to reserve some parking spaces on Mitchell, right in front of the Elks, kind of as a drop-off and pickup zone there. And to increase the number of handicapped spaces behind the Elks from 5 p.m. to 11 p.m. on New Year's Eve. And currently there's 4 spaces and we're going to increase that to 12.
I'll make a motion that we approve the request as presented from the Wexford County Historical Society.
Support.
I'm a little curious about why we don't have any form in front of us request.
There was a council communication in there.
There was? Oh, I apologize. I looked for it and I passed it.
It's right before the. It's on the back of the.
Oh, it's not like a form
that they filled out, right?
It's just an explanation.
So is this this just done verbally, or did they?
No, actually, there was a form originally, and then we brought. It was Cinnamon Finnerty in and talked to her with the event planning team, and this is what the group and her agreed to. So that is when I wrote the council communication.
Okay. Has anyone talked to any of the neighboring businesses? Like, that's the same block that Clam Lake Beer Company's on, for instance.
She did say that she had spoken to Clam Lake and they are in support of the event.
The for a point of clarification as well to the City Council, the initial request was for, I believe, was it 4 or 5 rows?
4 rows.
Yeah, for 4 rows of parking. And so we brought in the event organizer and met with her accordingly to get a better understanding as to the impact of the event, and this was the compromise that was reached in working with the staff team.
So there's going to be 5 spots in front of the Elks on Mitchell Street and then 12 behind, and those are for handicap spots.
Yeah. I know that the Historical Society has a significant amount of seniors that participate, and especially if we do get winter weather, having handicap spots is pretty essential for folks. Just getting across the parking lot with spotty ice and stuff is pretty treacherous. Hopefully they'll be right on that side, near to the Elks back entrance. And then a drop-off in front, 5 spaces for a drop-off. What's the thinking with that?
Temporary no parking signs up, and it's just going to be used so because some people apparently don't like to use the elevator.
It's terrifying.
And so they can be dropped off in the front and picked up, and then somebody can go park a vehicle.
Okay.
That was the intent there.
Okay, from the corner, so it's not going to be like half a block. It's going to, it'll start at that corner and be a few spaces.
Well, how many spots are in a block? It's a half a block.
I don't. Is it?
At least.
Well, the fortunate thing, at least on the back, those 12 spots, it'll be when the rest of the businesses in that area will be closed right for the night, too, so it won't affect their...
Well, the movie theater will be open, probably.
True.
And Clam Lake, but that's down at the other end. If you're handicapped, you're not going to park there and walk down to Clam Lake. I understand the need for a drop-off, too. Everybody's going to be dressed in their girl shoes and stuff. I get it.
It's a one-night event.
Yeah, I'm okay with it.
Okay.
The others complain, we'll know not to do it next year, I guess.
Right. We live and we learn, right?
Right. And again, we reduced it from 4 rows to just the 12 spots.
Yeah.
Good. Sandy, could we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Cave?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Mayor Felker?
Yes. Motion carries. Okay, the next thing that we have on our agenda this evening is a public hearing. And Marcus, would you like to introduce this?
Yes, thank you, Mayor, and members of the City Council. This evening, we are hosting a public hearing for Spencer Plastics. They had introduced at our last meeting an industrial facilities tax abatement in an amount of $812,714 for real property improvements. Before you this evening, we do have Mr. Theobald and Mr. Spencer.
This is Scott Monroe, who's the plant manager of Spencer Plastics.
And Scott Monroe, the plant manager from Spencer Plastics, who could perhaps provide a little more detail on the nature of the expansion and the improvements themselves. But per the application that was filed with us, this IFT will aid in the creation of 5 new positions, as well as help retain 27 existing positions. Jay or Scott, just a little bit about that.
I gave Scott a chance to speak, but he said I can just do this. So, this is great. We're adding an addition onto the building, the same size as the existing building. We've run out of room. We don't have any more room for machines. We ordered 3 machines. This whole project is like $1.5 million, but we don't need IFTs anymore on the equipment. So this is just on the building. So, and when we first started to come in, I look back on the IFTs today, and I think the first one was in 2013. And when they moved here, they had 18 employees. We're now up to 27, and with the amount of new programs they have coming on and new equipment, we'll have another 5 employees. And some of the jobs added are you know, shop floor jobs. Some of the jobs that have been added, here in the past are management positions. So, you know, it's a really good thing for the city. Any questions of anybody?
Where are you at with the project right now?
They have the foundation in. I think they have the walls up.
Yeah, foundation's in, block walls are up, and we're ready to start erecting the building, most likely next week.
So it should go fairly fast after that, yeah.
Goal is in January 1st to February.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that's, this building is mainly for storage area, and then they'll empty out the storage area that's in the building existing, and we'll have room to, you know, for the expansion and new equipment. It's pretty, I don't know, anybody up here, you been in there, Marcus?
I haven't been in there since the renovations were complete. I was in there prior to that.
Prior, okay. But it's a pretty fascinating place. It's a pretty exceptional place. It's really clean. There's, you know, nice polished floors. The logos are in the two logos in the floor, the, you know, machines. A lot of automation goes into it, yet, you know, we still have increased employees. Machines sit there and run, and robots pick parts off and put them on, and so it's pretty impressive place. And I've been in quite a few manufacturing facilities, and this one is a really nice place to work. So,
okay, thank you.
Well, Mr. Monroe, we've been able to thank Mr. Thibault for your move to Cadillac, because that was one of the rare ones where we actually were able to do a transfer of an IFT. And it's really nice to see the additions, which we knew were coming, and seeing that growth happen here. So I know that Mr. Thibault's probably passed it on, but we're very thankful for you and the employees, and it's been a great addition to our community. And it's really nice to be, now that we're not doing the personal property, it's nice to see where they're expanding the buildings. That usually is going to mean jobs, and it's going to mean growth. So I'd like to, with that introduction, make a motion that we approve the resolution that is presented in front of us that would approve.
A public hearing, though, so we're going to have to open the floor.
Yeah, that's true. Okay. So, sorry about that.
I appreciate your enthusiasm. But first, we're going to go ahead and open up the public.
I was ready to tell him the public hearing wasn't closed.
Oh, okay. We'll go ahead and open the public hearing. So if there's anyone else who would like to ask questions or participate in the discussion.
They were probably all going to, then I shot the idea. Yeah. Spoiled the fun.
Yeah, probably not. If not, we'll go ahead and close the public comment and move into council discussion and look for a motion.
Go ahead.
You have any discussion?
No, that's okay.
I'll make a motion then for the second time that to approve the IFT in the amount of $812,714 for Spencer Plastics Incorporated, and approve the resolution as well as the letter of agreement as presented.
Support.
Sandy, could we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Mayor Falk?
Yes. Motion carries. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, that moves us to the city manager's report this evening.
Thank you, Mayor and members of the City Council. This first item is with respect to bids and a recommendation regarding the repainting of our water tower. As members of Council may or may not recall, that is what was decided upon with respect to the coloring and the graphic. We have the bid before you this evening with our recommendation. The one thing that's going to be different is that the lettering that says City of and then Michigan will not be painted on the tower because it simply won't be seen. It's going to be too small of too small of a print, and according to Jeff Dielen, our utilities director, who heard this through the contractor, that if you're at the street level and you're looking up at it, it'll just look like lines, like a line on the top and a line on the bottom. You're not going to be able to really see what it says. So with respect to graphical representation, which we did our best to try to show, it should look like that when it's all said and done, just minus the word City of and then Michigan underneath. So so before you tonight is a chart showing you the bids that we had received. The recommended action is to award the contract for the water tower painting to LC United Painting of Sterling Heights, Michigan, in the amount of $362,000. Funds for this project are available in the Water and Sewer Fund. It will do the full inside and outside of the tower, and if you have any specific questions about the nature of the work, Jeff or I could perhaps address them.
So when are they going to start this project?
It'll probably be next May they'll start it, because it takes a few weeks and you got to count for rain days and stuff like that. So it'd be next spring they'll start. And obviously if it's nicer weather, they could start even earlier, but I think around May would be when they'd actually start for a normal year. Mm-hmm.
So. When they took a look at that logo, did they consider taking those swishy things off too? Do you know what I mean? The
swoosh, the Cadillac swoosh.
The thing at the top and the thing at the bottom, because it's out the city of and Michigan, then they kind of don't, it doesn't make sense really to have those maybe, and maybe we should just stick to Cadillac without the brush stroke swishes on the top and the bottom.
No, they did not consider that. I think we said we want it the wave, you know, as I call it, the swoosh is the wave, and the city of Cadillac in Michigan, I could understand what they're saying. The actual letters of them would not be visible up from the highway. You just see a line, because they'll be small, but we could ask them to take away the swoosh. I mean,
I like the whole logo being on there.
It will look like our logo. I mean, I don't know how many people read City of and Michigan when they read it. I just see Cadillac. I mean, that's all I see.
Right, and from the highway, that's what they'll see. But we'll see City of Cadillac, Michigan.
If I may interject, Councilmember Spolman, I think you might be right if I'm thinking that your concern is when you look up, you might not necessarily be able to see the swoosh, the actual design. If you're sort of right on it and you're looking up, it might just look like a line. Is that what you're thinking?
No, I'm just thinking that everything fit together at one time with the City of and Cadillac and then the swooshes, but now that you're taking away a part of it, those swooshes look more like a mistake.
That's a good pick. I mean, like
something
that one, if you look
off
at
the back seat. Right. To me,
if you look at the one on that TV, it's far enough away where you don't see the
I see her point, because you would think that that looked like it was
yeah, right over that one.
Yeah.
It looks like maybe the lines faded out in the rest or something, that's been worn off or something. Mm-hmm. And you said the main question on the wording, it's just not going to be large enough.
Yeah, if the regular letters are, 8 foot or 10 foot tall, those little letters are going to be a foot tall. Well, by the time you get to the highway and you're looking at it, you just won't be able to see it. You'll be able to see the big letters, because they'll be so much bigger than the rest. It's just, when you look at the size compared to the actual Cadillac, they're significantly smaller.
It'll be about 2 feet.
I think you're right about if without the lettering that.
I mean, they can put the lettering on. It's just you're going to pay for something you won't be able to read. You won't be able to read City of and Michigan. It'll be, if you want it there, they can put it there.
Is the lettering and the swoosh going to be black, or is the swoosh going to be a darker blue?
It's going to be a darker blue.
Like our logo?
Yeah. So. Turn it. It is kind of janky without the others coming into it. I get your point.
But you can get a coin.
I used to play with logos a lot.
Yeah. What?
I used to do logos a lot.
Right.
When I was at the hospital.
Okay, I'm looking at this.
Yeah, I would either do it in its entirety, or I would get rid of the swooshes too. Mm. I like having Michigan on there.
Jeff, is that, does that price include the full amount with the city of and Michigan?
No, but I can't believe it'd be that much more to have city of and Michigan on it. And I would say I like it better with the swoosh. So if you guys, I'd put city of and Michigan on it and know that you can't read it rather than get rid of the swoosh.
Can they bold the city of and Michigan a little bit more?
Instead of gray, because it's in a gray tones now.
They can do whatever you want. If you know, it's all money. it's all an increase of money every time we do something there. So
when are you going to do this again? So
last one was over 15 years ago.
Right. So we want to
do it well.
Right.
We're going to do the swishy. Look at how the ink pans.
You know, the other, I hate to be a pain in the patootie, but
that would make more sense.
You know, somebody could go by and think it's a Cadillac plant. Of course, the Cadillac logo is different than ours.
I was looking at the swoosh that you have on the ink pens for the city of Cadillac. That combination makes more sense. I mean, you probably had to do that other line differently because of the pole, but
that's what the swoosh is supposed to look like.
Oh, yeah. Let's see.
All right, we got to pass it back.
Yeah, I got to see that.
This is so funny.
That makes sense.
All right, so.
I mean, if you did that without the wording, it would have a better design, I think. But
more of a swoosh like they have on the top, more of a curve.
Yeah.
And longer, where it looks the swoosh is combined.
It's like it goes.
So it looks like, so it looks like it goes, but that's redesigning the logo. That's not the logo.
Yeah, it's the same on there.
Yeah.
Again, you know, once they make a like a stencil, and then they'll put that on and they'll paint it. So if you want it more of a swoosh, they'll just make a stencil with more of a swoosh.
I also heard from council that perhaps we should still keep city of and Michigan on it and ask them to just bold it a little bit darker.
Mm-hmm.
And we can do that. What I would recommend then for this evening is that we table this. Have Jeff
give us another look.
Reach back out and make sure we've got the right number that we're bringing forward, because I'm not comfortable asking for approval with the number that we have this evening, because the number this evening takes off the city of.
Yeah, but you wouldn't want to rebid the whole thing, would you?
No.
I can't guarantee they'll hold their price, Marcus. There's five other firms there too that's gonna know what this price was, and once these guys put a different number out, they're gonna ask why they can't put a different number out.
So you want to award it to the firm and then know that it's gonna be a different price? I mean, it's.
We could just do a change order. I mean, you could award it and then do a change order.
That's a ticket.
And that way.
Let's do that.
Okay.
But I would appreciate seeing the whole logo there and city of in Michigan darker.
Okay.
To see if we could see it. Because I like the initial thought of having our logo on the water tower.
I do too.
Is that all right?
Like it was originally supposed to have been kind of like a ribbon, say.
Yeah, yeah.
That's exactly what it was.
And that shows it more, doesn't it?
They took that out so that you could see the rest of the letters, but that's exactly what it was. And you can see that from your pen. That's a good example of
that. That would be the logo. Yeah. The other one looks more like it's just a line.
So it's not really a swoosh.
That's all you are going to see is
part of a ribbon.
Yeah.
Two parts of a ribbon.
Yeah.
So how do you guys feel about just going with Cadillac?
I like the Michigan.
You like
and the city of, okay. I do.
All right.
I do.
All right, so let's just take the time to have the company give us another look, see at it, and then we can make a decision.
But let's award this and then do a...
Sure, yeah. Right.
Okay. I mean, or let's vote.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so could we have a motion for that?
Soon.
I'll make a motion to award the contract for the water tower painting to LC United Painting in the amount of $362,000.
Support.
Sandy, could we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Spolman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Heath?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes. Yes. Motion carries.
Thank you. We will bring that back as soon as we have any additional numbers for that.
Okay.
It's interesting, ever since we've been talking about this, I've been noticing the water tower, the gray and the stuff on it that I just, you know, I drive that past it every single day. And I would drive past it like something every single day, and I'm like, yeah, that's gonna look sweet pretty soon.
Mayor, members of the City Council, this next item is a recommendation regarding prosecutorial services. Our fee schedule with the Wexford County Prosecutor's Office is expiring December 31st, 2015. The City and the Prosecutor's Office is interested in continuing our arrangement, and the Prosecutor's Office has agreed to hold the fee flat for another couple of years. Also important to note that the fee has not changed since the inception of our arrangement, our collaborative arrangement with the county. Your agenda packet does include a copy of the extension agreement, and the annual fee is $30,240.
Mm-hmm. I'll make a motion to extend the contract with the Wexford County Prosecuting Attorney through December 31st, 2017, as in the contract here.
Support.
Sandy, could we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Stevens?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Coleman?
Yes.
Mayor Folkes?
Yes. Motion carries.
Thank you. The next item, Mayor and members of the City Council, is item C, which we added this evening. This is in regards to a sewer replacement project on the alley or in the alley between First Avenue and Second Avenue. The city, sort of in summary, began a project that we anticipated to be rather small in nature. There was an area in town where we were dealing with sewer issues, and replacing the line was required to do. We thought we were able to do it well within our spending authority, based upon information in our GIS and known depths that we had to work with. We thought we were fine. Unfortunately, however, according to Jeff Dietland, our utilities director, after they started digging the project, it turns out that some of the depths were off, and that the condition of the soils were such where, I think you said that, Jeff, there were cave-ins
occurring. Yes, there was cave-ins, and with it being deeper, the holes are getting bigger than what we anticipated.
So the project, long and short of it, is going to come in over the $7,500 spending authority. We already started this project. We'd like to continue, obviously, in finishing this project and getting the new line established. We don't know exactly how much over it's going to be. We know that, or we're fairly confident, it's certainly not going to double. We're working with a local area contractor that we've worked with in the past, and have great confidence in that company's ability. But we are asking City Council this evening to waive bidding as one action, and then to award up to $15,000 to Dunbar Excavating to complete this project. And there are funds available in our water and sewer fund accordingly.
A clarification question, is that $15,000 in addition to the $7,400, or does that include the...
No, that's the whole thing.
I'll make a motion to waive competitive bidding for the sewer replacement project on the alley between First and Second Avenue.
Support.
Sandy, can we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Shippers?
Yes.
Heath?
Yes.
Coleman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Mayor Phil?
Yes. Motion carries.
And at this point, it'd be appropriate for a motion for the $15,000.
Okay, I'll do that. When the motion to authorize the Dunbar Excavating to complete the project at a cost of up to $15,000.
Support. Sandy, could we have the roll call, please?
Councilmember Shippers?
Yes.
Coleman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Mayor Coe?
Yes. Motion carries.
Thank you, Mayor and members of the City Council. Item D, which also we just added a very brief update on the special election. Wanted to mention that the nomination petitions will be available on Wednesday. We're working on, I should say Sandy, our city clerk, is working on the math and making sure we understand, yes, how many are needed for the ward, how many signatures are needed, and then that public notice will go out as well, but Wednesday is the day that we're targeting. And then they will be due on Friday, January 15th.
Cool.
Is the due date. And that is the update.
Thank you.
Unless, did you have anything to add, Mike?
The only thing I wanted to add is that originally, I think last time we had told the council January the 12th. The reason for that is the charter says, as we read the charter, we used 8 weeks, 8 weeks from the point of the election. But the charter, as Sandy pointed out, the charter actually says from the Friday preceding the election. So it's not necessarily 8 weeks from the Tuesday election. It's from the Friday preceding that election, 8 weeks back, which changes the date from January 12th to January the 15th. So we issued a corrected letter to the county clerk today indicating it is the January 15 date. And
so you took 3 more days away from them.
Unfortunately, yep. Yes, they did.
Thank you, Sandy.
Are they still our friends?
Sandy found it. Sandy found it.
Good job. First of all, I apologize. I wasn't here. I mentioned that to council member Keith on Thursday. I was supposed to fill in on a they know this is scary, on a basketball coaching duty for 2 weeks, and it got extended because of the way the coach's surgery went. But I don't know if what Mr. Reiser brought up, if that was just more background information or if there was anything that was of a concern with the charter part that from that previous meeting or not?
I don't think that there was a concern. I think that, you know, to his point, the way the charter was written, it gave us a good roadmap on how we should deal with it. But there was some discussion that evening about the fact that we might want to open up the charter and update some things. And so perhaps that's what kind of triggered him to come and say the charter did work the way that we meant it to. And so,
okay,
yeah,
but it worked because there's no state precedent. Would you explain that? Because isn't it not in compliance with normal election dates?
Yeah. So this March presidential primary would not have been a regular election, but for the governor signing the most recent bill, making it a regular election. When that happened, then. Bureau of Elections, this election for the city would not have been covered under Michigan election law, because for normal regular elections, the period, I believe, is 15 weeks in advance when nominating petitions would be due. But in this case, it does not apply to the city's election in this case, which means we fall back to the charter, which requires the 8 weeks or the 8 Fridays preceding the election. But there are, I will say too, there are some obvious conflicts with Michigan law. So since the charter was drafted, there have been changes in the law that should be corrected as part of the charter revision if the city chooses to do that. You're required to follow state law anyways, so it's not something that we're unaware of. But there are little things also here and there in terms of the charter that, while implicitly covered, or not. And I'll give you a perfect example. In this case, anyways, we had the resignation of a council member. And that technically is not covered under your vacancy provision in your charter. It refers to death and disability of those members or non-attendance, but nothing in there refers to resignation.
Oh.
Okay. Now, I don't think anybody would argue that the seat's still occupied where you have a resignation or somebody just leaves, for example. I don't think you have to wait for that time period under your charter by which they haven't attended a certain number of meetings to declare a vacancy. So, but that's one area in which, you know, you could get some clarification.
Right.
Mr. Homier, too, with some of the charter changes, when it becomes state law, that just requires a resolution of the council versus an election of the electorate in terms of I know this isn't totally on this topic, but it kind of is, because, you know, our charter currently states in the charter about the, you know, the petitions being in so many Tuesdays prior to the election, but since then the state's changed it. But can that be something that's just done by a council resolution because it's in complying with a state law change versus having to have it approved by an election of the residents?
So you mean the actual change to the charter? Are you talking about amending the charter by resolution to comply with state law?
Correct.
Yeah.
And the reason I bring that up is with that new 15 weeks to turn in your petition, in all fairness to a resident, if they looked on the online in our charter, they would read that they had to have it in by 8 weeks.
Right.
But that's not accurate. But it also, if they read that, they would think they had, if they don't have a newspaper, which is great, the paper covers it, but if they don't, they would think, and that happened this last election where somebody was thinking, I have 8 Tuesdays prior, and then found out it was after the fact, because really the law is 15 weeks.
Right.
So it'd be nice if we, and I think we've done that previously before, where it was just a resolution by our council to change that charter because of it being a state law.
Yeah, I'll have to double check. I don't think you can actually change the wording of the charter by resolution to comply with state law. But what the city has done in the past is where there are provisions that are different, they've noted it on the charter so that you might have different notice provisions or different time frames, and it will say something like, this was preempted by MCL such and such, okay? So to give people some idea. But those are changes that I think that you would have to go through that charter revision to actually change. You could pass a resolution certainly informing the public of it, but it's not going to change directly the language. Yeah.
And that's one of those where that state law dictates on the charter versus some things the charter would be allowed.
Yeah. Which is why, like in this case, there was no Michigan election law on point for the city's election that is filling the vacancy here. And so that's when you go back to the charter and say it's 8 weeks or 8 Fridays prior to the election that you use as a basis for nominating petitions. Right.
Okay. Then that moves us to introduction of ordinances and resolutions.
Thank you, Mayor and members of the City Council. This evening, we have a request for consideration of a resolution that will introduce an ordinance that amends our zoning code to add language for a mixed planned unit development. The purpose of tonight's update is simply to set the public hearing. John Wallace, the Director of Community Development, is here this evening and will run us through a snapshot of the work that's happened to date on this. Thank you.
Thank you, John. I'm going to back up just a little bit for the benefit of the folks at home and people that might have just joined this discussion as of late. We just recently completed a major update to the city's master plan, and that plan required a lot of work on behalf of the Planning Commission, required the Planning Commission to review and give their final input on what they thought should be in the master plan, ultimately making a recommendation of that master plan to the council, and the council also having to approve that plan. The dates for the approval are on the first two bullets of the first slide, which got us through the entire master plan adoption. Of course, with that master plan update, many of these areas of the city did not see major changes in what was proposed, but we did have major vacant parcels of land in the city that required a special focus during that plan. One such parcel was the Terry D. site, also been referred to as Cadillac Junction. With a lot of discussion of the owners of that property and a lot of proposals on the part of the potential developer, consensus was reached at the Planning Commission level that the best way to proceed with that area was through a mixed-use development. But not only did they think it should be a mixed-use development, they thought it was essential to do it under a planned unit development process, which is essentially kind of almost like a custom way to build the zoning for that site around some general parameters that you would build for that site. And so, and part of that was a recognition that there was many people in the audience during those discussions that seemed like a lot of their concerns, not only with regard to the use, but was impact to the adjoining residential developments. Well, nothing gives you a better chance or opportunity to negotiate design parameters that could benefit and reduce impacts to adjoining development other than something that was done by a PUD process. So that is why the decision to go that direction. Upon completion of the plan, and with a very specific wording in the plan that the city was to follow that process, it came to our attention that the current ordinance did not have any provisions to take action on to rezone into a mixed planned unit development district PUD. And since we did not have such a process, in anticipation that there would probably be a desire for the Terry D developers, for instance, to want to make use of this new district, but not only for them, we stepped back a little bit and said, in addition to Terry D, there could be a number of other large parcels where it would make sense at some point for someone to apply for a mixed-use planned unit development. That being the case, we drafted, myself and Mike Homier drafted a mixed planned unit development zoning district, which could be used by any number of large parcels within the city where it would make sense to mix residential and commercial uses. So that is the path that we were on. The draft of the ordinance that we put together or wrote together was presented to the Planning Commission and a setting of the public hearing at their regular meeting on October 26th of 2015. At the early meeting, other than some rather obvious oversight issues on the ordinance, there wasn't extensive discussion, but we did change just some real minor clarifications after the initial meeting on October 26th. The Planning Commission then did hold a public hearing on the zoning amendment on their November 23rd regular meeting. After the public hearing, fortunately, we did not get a lot of negative feedback, particular to the wording of the ordinance and how it was drafted and how it would be used to regulate the development of the property. That being the case, there were some minor changes that were made to the ordinance, and those minor changes were more of a clarification for how you determine right away. Someone suggested at the public hearing that it was typical in some ordinances to also include on the site plan structures within 300 feet of the boundary of the PUD. Certainly that that change made sense. So we used the input from the public hearing, and we made some changes, and we also did some clarification changes. Now, those clarifications and changes are in your packet in the draft. I think they're maybe in blue ink. You'll see that they're very minor in nature and don't change the general content of the ordinance.
They're highlighted and underlined in gray.
Depends on what printer they were on.
Yes, various shades of gray.
So the Planning Commission held their public hearing and made a recommendation to the City Council that the City Council approve the zoning ordinance amendment as revised and stated at their meeting that they made that vote. Now, that brings us to today, where the City Council is introducing the zoning amendment, which is at tonight's meeting, and is being asked to set a date for the public hearing. The city will have to address this ordinance probably over at least two meetings, and there will probably be a meeting skipped. And the reason for that is that, again, as earlier discussion talking about different statutes, we have to honor both the city charter, but we also have to honor and respect the state enabling legislation on zoning. And so because the council will have to hold a public hearing, the notice requirement would be the same as for the Planning Commission holding the public hearing, which is at least a 15-day notice period. And of course, the notice can't go out until an actual vote is taken to set the hearing, so that notice will go out sometime shortly after this meeting if that vote is taken. So that is why the actual public hearing will not be at the very next meeting, but one beyond that.
January 4th is the date.
Mm-hmm. Based on, on the information you've been presented tonight in your resolutions, the proposal date for that public hearing is January 4th. And the council certainly could make a vote following that public hearing, either on that date or, if they felt it necessary, at a later date if they felt any additional discussion was needed or potential changes were needed. But certainly that wouldn't be necessary if things were deemed to be in order and appropriate at that meeting. You could take the vote, and then once the vote were taken, just we would follow the normal publication and stating of the date of effect of the ordinance, and then that stating of that date of effect would then be the date that a potential developer could approach the city to make use of the ordinance. Now, the amendment doesn't rezone the property. It's a text amendment to the ordinance, which creates an opportunity for another district. And that district then, what somebody would do is come to the city, and they would approach the city concurrently, not only with a request to go into that zoning district, but also to they could concurrently submit an actual development plan along with that, which then would kind of shorten the review process. It wouldn't shorten any steps in terms of things that we looked at, but it would certainly streamline the process and make it more efficient and allow the entire issue to be looked at once. So that kind of is a summary of where we were and where we are now. And if anyone has any questions, I'd be happy to answer that.
So the revisions that are here now, that's due to public input of mainly nearby residents, is that correct? Or some of it is?
Yeah, the There was very limited comment. I think there may have been only, it was either one or two comments that were related to the content itself. There was some discussion that tried to go back to a place where we had already finished discussion, which was on the designation of the parcels as mixed land use. And to my recollection, we included any formal recommendation that was oriented towards the content, either whether it was from the public or whether it was from the Planning Commission members.
Okay.
So will this, the Cadillac Junction, right, property is zoned mixed use. Will this change it to mixed planned mixed use, or what happens with that?
Well, they would file a request on whatever forms we present them to file for that request to zone that property into the mixed mixed plan unit development zoning district. And in so doing, they would also then being following the development review process that is specified in that zoning district language. Optimally, the best thing to do would be for them to kind of do it concurrently with the presentation or the submittal of their development plan. Now, the way we set up the ordinance was to have the plan be submitted in two stages. One would be what we call in the ordinance a sketch plan, kind of a misnomer because it really contains maybe 80 or 90% of everything that's going to be on the development plan ultimately. So it's not like a real basic concept. It's really a fairly complete picture of what's going to happen on the site. And then subsequently, at a later stage, then they submit the final development plan. And that final development plan, in general, would just be adding some very minute, detailed-oriented, usually engineering-oriented parameters for the development project. In the first phase, the sketch plan, you'll have a very good idea of exactly the nature of the uses, the positioning of the uses, the design, the site design that that they are proposing be in use for the project.
If I may also add on to that, just to clarify a couple of things. As John mentioned in the beginning of the presentation, the city zoning code currently doesn't have a provision that allows for or designation or classification, zoning classification that would allow for a mixed-use PUD. As a part of the master planning process, when the land use was identified by the Planning Commission and then subsequently ratified by the City Council as a part of the whole master plan update, that the parcel that annexed off of 55 and 131, the Terry D property, if you will, was identified as a use that would be a mixed use. And then furthermore, it went on to say how it would require, or the city would require it to be a mixed PUD, a mixed planned unit development. We then realized that we needed to make sure that we actually had that language built in, that classification built into our zoning code, which we did not. And so what we're doing here is creating that language in a general enough way where not only the Terry D folks could apply for that classification, but anybody in the city that has property that can meet the criteria set forth in the ordinance could apply for that zoning classification. The current zoning of the Terry D property, the Cadillac Junction property, is actually R1. And so as they would go through the process that John described, once this is in place, and they would submit their site plan or their sketch plan, and then they would submit the application for the new zoning classification, that's when the Planning Commission and then ultimately the City Council will be reviewing and considering their requests.
Okay.
That helps.
That makes sense. That helps. Thanks.
What type of provisions or encouragement
Do you have in here for energy efficient type of building or LEED buildings, LEED certified? Is there anything like that in here?
I don't think.
Or the use of recycled materials. I mean, you have a lot of prohibited materials.
I don't think we have any specific language. I think there are some general standards which give the city some discretion in design parameters. And at some level, I think those could be used to take a look at that if they were kind of within an accepted practice, you know, in the field, I believe.
That's disappointing to me. I think that it's important that we try to push that type of development in our community. The other thing that I would like to see more prominent, and you know, this is, there's a lot of information here, so I'm probably missing it somewhere. There's a whole bunch of information about landscape buffers, which I really appreciate, but I saw it earlier, and now I'm not seeing it about lighting design. And if that all happens during the application process.
Right. There would actually end up being a development agreement as well as a site plan document. And between a combination of the site plan document and the agreement, the parameters that govern the lighting would be covered in that agreement. And it, quite frankly, it has become very common to have dark sky provisions in lighting. In fact, I don't know too many developers now that don't already expect that or know that in terms of having the light capped and shielded downward and not going up into the sky, but very focused lighting on the things that the lighting is supposed to be actually lighting up, whether it be walkways or parking lots or that type of thing.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I'm switching the subject, so if you want to talk about lighting.
Yeah, I was going to try to pull it up, but I know that our code currently has some details on lighting restrictions. It doesn't use the term dark sky, but I recall reading something in the code about the requirement for directional lighting and some other language to that matter. And I think the ordinance language refers back to the code that we already have. And I'll see if I can find it and share it with you.
That is one very nice part about the way it was written. It borrows a lot from the code that we have now as kind of a starting point, whether it be the lighting provisions or the parking provisions. But then it also gives the ability to go either further or back some of those down, depending on what the specific nature of the development is. One thing that many planners have found through the years is that they got way too ambitious with the amount of parking spaces that they would require for a development. And so you'd have these shopping centers that would never approach even being three quarters full. And then you have to provide runoff for all those parking lots, and you have all that extra pollution, and it's like there's no need for that.
John, if I can just quickly read the first, this is what's already in our code currently. It says all outdoor lighting in all use districts used to light the general area of a specific site shall be shielded to reduce glare and shall be so arranged as to reflect lights away from all adjacent residential districts or adjacent residences. And then it goes on to talk about, you know, lighting needs to be confined to ground areas of lawns or parking lots. It does mention how it can be used to illuminate, you know, buildings on the, you know, the external illumination of buildings. And there's a few more provisions, but there's some pretty good language.
Is that for all new construction, or is that existing? Because we have a lot of that don't fall into that category.
It doesn't specify. It's section 46-665 of our code.
Is that within the zoning ordinance itself? Generally, if it's in the zoning ordinance, it would apply to new development, either expansions to existing businesses or totally new development, either one. It doesn't exempt the people who want to expand current facilities, but they're grandfathered in on if somebody that's just was approved under a different set of standard years ago, you don't bring them up to the current code standard in the zoning code.
And the city attorney just pointed out a section, I think there might be a couple of different ones, but actually within the draft PUD language, it says the PUD site features including but not limited to walkways, exterior lighting, play areas, common areas, building entry points, garage and storage areas. Landscaping and signs have been appropriately designed and arranged to complement the principal municipal PUD buildings and uses and avoid adverse impacts on adjacent property or uses. Was there something else?
There are a lot of provisions. The heavy lifting in this in the PUD will be during site plan review, and there are a lot of general categories that can be used then when you review plans, site plans, that may be very broad and general now, and it's intended then that you will focus in on those areas like lighting or like energy efficient buildings, which may not be specifically covered, but certainly, for example, on page 13, just looking at subparagraph E, where it says the basis for conditions. And that section says, due to the nature of the MPUD, additional conditions may be required by the Planning Commission or the City Council. Any condition imposed by the Planning Commission or City Council must be reasonable and intended to do one or more of the following. Ensure that the public services and facilities will be capable of accommodating increased services, protect the natural environment, conserve natural resources and energy, ensure compatibility with adjacent land uses, promote the use of land in socially and economically desirable manner. I mean, these are very broad categories, but it is, by its very nature, being a planned unit development, intended to provide a lot of flexibility in adapting the uses to the site and in conjunction with other land uses, adjacent land uses. And that's where you're really gonna see this all come together. But Marcus is right, what this ordinance does, it creates the district and the process by which you can then evaluate the request to rezone the property and give site plan approval for a piece of property that exists.
Answer me then, Mike, why is it so specific about what are prohibited materials and which ones are, you know, allowed?
So there,
I understand that.
So there has to be some basic framework for standards, but in those standards, then you can have variation. So even with the permitted materials, I wouldn't necessarily. There's certainly a list of prohibited materials. Certainly there is that. But even the list of generalized materials, I wouldn't look at that even under this ordinance as sort of an exhaustive list of materials that might be used, because these other broad categories are broad enough where you might say, well, the developer is offering to use this recycled material and it's a new sort of use of this material. Can you allow that? Yes, you can allow it. And all of that's going to sort of blend in together with the review process, the site plan review, and ultimately the development agreement, because you'll have site plans. So like when we talk about the buffer, it's hard to envision how that might look, but all that's going to be included on a landscape plan, where the development agreement should be almost as easy as saying, here's the sketch plan, here's the final plan, this is what's going to be built subject to these additional conditions, right? So you may want some specific conditions as to the exact nature of the lighting that you might prefer in there. And those are all things that will come together as you go through this process. PUDs, by their very nature, are sort of hard at first to get your arms around, because they're intended to provide innovative design and flexibility for specific sites. And that's what this is trying to do.
In reality, it's an advanced form of zoning. I was the manager in Caledonia Township near Grand Rapids. And I think we probably, not just during my tenure, but I think on file, we probably had 20 to 30 PUD agreements on file. And so it almost became the norm to do all new development through PUD in Caledonia. And in my, you know, in the experience that I had with it, it was almost a preferred way to handle the development, because it gave all parties the ability to, you know, not work with a one-size-fits-all set of standards, which, quite frankly, doesn't fit every combination of businesses falling together. And so it allows you to react to individual parameters of the individual project. So I think it's actually better for the city and better for the developer.
Okay, one more question, if I may. Sorry. In this process.
Can I interrupt you just real quick? And that is with respect to the materials, you know, so the process right now is to introduce the ordinance and set it for a public hearing. If by the time the council considers this and wants to add, subtract, provide some variation to this language, we can do that. That's not a big issue. So if there's a specific building material that you think is appropriate for consideration, not either that the developer is going to use it or that you'll ultimately require it on a particular site, we can, now is the time to adjust that language to include that language so that you have that flexibility.
You know, I'm more concerned about the prohibited, because there's some really innovative things you can do with some reuse on some of these materials. That surprises me that wood isn't allowed.
The issue with the wood is it, unless it's well kept, maintained in harsh climates, it deteriorates the quickest. Now, maybe you would require, as part of that development agreement, a maintenance schedule be developed, which I've done too. So I'm not suggesting that this is the language that you might ultimately pass as part of your review. And what I'm suggesting to you is, if there are specific instances in here where you think, well, prohibited is a little too harsh, maybe it's generally prohibited but subject to variation provided it's used as an architectural feature of some of the buildings. That may provide you with greater flexibility in determining what is or is not prohibited.
Okay, thanks. You're so accommodating.
Well, in the end, it's your ordinance, right?
I know.
And so I want I want the city council to be comfortable with what's going on and how you will see when there's an application made under this ordinance, you will see how this all comes together. So the main thing you should be thinking of at this point is PUDs are designed to give you flexibility in how you apply this zoning district.
And I would really encourage, I know that it's another meeting, but I would encourage, as we step through some of these things, Council Member Spolman, you know, your questions are really good. And you know, if you have the opportunity to come and sit at a planning meeting and listen to some of the discussions and the questions and the public comments, I think that it will help us here. And, you know, so that we understand how the Planning Commission gets where they go, and also we can put our comments in for them to be thinking about as they're working on it.
Well, hopefully my next question is won't take so long, and so much of everybody's time, but at what point do we consider access to this planned unit for other modes of transportation besides vehicles, pedestrians and bicycles? Is that in this? Is that required to be considered?
There are. Certainly aspects of that within the development and tying that development into adjacent properties, but none directly about transportation to and from the site from other off-site locations. Although I expect that will be addressed as part of site plan review. So, for example, if the question comes up, well, are you going to have bus service, you know, as part of an option, or sidewalks or other public transportation facilities? Those are going to be planned as part of site plan review, certainly on-site requirements. And then I suppose the larger part, and this may be a better question for John, is that, you know, as part of your master plan review and your transportation needs and those things, typically addressed through that process. So, you know, I think it's going to be a combination of both, but...
The only thing I wanted to just add to what Mike said is that we must remember, too, that this language isn't specifically being tailored for that Terry D project.
I know.
So as Mike mentioned,
That's hard for me to separate. I agree.
Yeah, and it is. And the reality also is that it's probably going to be rare that we get another PUD zoning classification application request in shortly after this, this becomes part of our ordinance from a party other than the Terry D property folks. But it's certainly possible. But as the city attorney commented, you'll have, you know, that aspect of the plan will get reviewed as a part of the site plan review and the construction of the development agreement itself. So, and if you recall from the very preliminary concept that was shared with city council, I want to say it was in the summer, there was discussion of the trail system, internal trail system, and some other intermodal systems besides vehicular.
So if you look on page 4, and this falls under parking and circulation, there are some aspects of that fall under this section. So it talks about, you know, all adjoining public, private driveways, internal roadways having to be shown. And the Planning Commission or City Council may require, and then a list of those 8 items, other traffic circulation improvements necessary. Those obviously are all on site, which is within the city's authority to regulate, as well as the next item G regarding pedestrian circulation. So the ordinance is drafted so as to make sure you're taking into consideration all of those things on site in terms of both vehicular and pedestrian access and circulation.
With M55 being a state trunk line, I think the Planning Commission has been leaning towards letting MDOT take lead in terms of reviewing traffic count projections for the development, whether they phase it or do an entire build out, which, you know, we don't know yet, but there should be traffic projections done for each phase of the project. And I would believe that MDOT would be reviewing the projections and accordingly then working with the developer to see what might be necessary. Would there be an access lane just for access to the site? Would it consist of deceleration tapers or just general driveway tapers? There's a whole series of different traffic techniques that get used depending on what the volume of traffic are, and they might change over time as the project builds out. Maybe the ultimate build out isn't there, you know, for 3 to 5 years into the project. But I would think we would work closely with MDOT on the auto portion, at least as it relates to the entry points to the project. I think the internal transportation, whether it be car, bicycle, bus, whatever, I think would fall more to the city in looking to what is going to be proposed as part of the site plan development process itself. So if we, for instance, think there needs to be a set place for the small bus system to drop, it would be important to figure out where those locations would be in relationship to the uses. But yeah, collectively we will.
If there aren't sidewalks developed or if there aren't bike lanes developed, people from the neighboring neighborhoods or from the city aren't going to want to approach it in anything other than a car. And so it's important that we work together on that.
I totally agree. In fact, I anticipate that we'll be taking that very subject up at the Planning Commission meetings.
That'd be
great. Talk to your commissioner. Talk to the Planning Commissioners. Attend.
So, here to set the public hearing.
Yes. So, do we have a motion to set the public hearing?
The only one, and it's a small thing, but that way the ordinance is on the 17 page. I think the approval date needs to be a change. I don't know if that'll matter to putting that so that the official ordinance has the right that date, but.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll go ahead and make the motion to adopt the resolution to introduce the ordinance amending the zoning ordinance to add a mixed planned unit development, boy, that's a lot to say, zoning district, and set up the public hearing for zoning of the public hearing for January 4th, 2016. That's the main part.
Support.
Sandy, could we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Spohman?
Yes.
Stevens?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Mayor.
Yes. Motion carries.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Mayor and members of the City Council. This next item is the request of consideration of the adoption of an ordinance that will adopt adoption of a resolution that will adopt the performance resolution for governmental agencies. This is a document from MDOT that we have received in the past. This year we have added the titles only per MDOT's advice and have removed the names. This is a document that's required that they have on file for the city with respect to our annual permit applications for banners and highway closures. And as I mentioned, we have taken names out of the resolution per their advice, they being MDOT, and added position titles. It's our understanding, and this may change, but it's our understanding that this then may be the last time you'll see this resolution coming forward. They said once we have just the titles only and not the names, then they don't need us to refresh it annually, but we'll see what happens next year. So.
Or we consolidate and change titles or something, you never know.
Well, or
never say never.
Or MDOT might say, well, we still want the refresh.
Yeah.
So. I'll make a motion to adopt the performance resolution for governmental agencies.
Support. Gotcha.
Sandy, should we have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Stevens?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Shippers?
Yes.
Bowman?
Yes.
Mayor Fulton?
Yes. Motion carries. We also have in our packets this evening the minutes of the Dog Park Advisory Committee meeting, which was held on October 15th, along with the minutes of the Wexford County Airport Authority meeting held on November 11th, 2015. At this time, we'll open the floor for public comment. We do ask if you come forward, if you state your name, and if you would also write your name and your address and limit your time to 3 minutes, it would be appreciated.
My name is George Giftis, and surprise, I'm not going to talk about the PUD. what is there a way to get the picture of the water tower back up there? Okay, suggestion. Part of the problem with trying to put the logo on that tower is the curvature of the face that you're painting it on. And it just a suggestion is you might want to look at putting a flat sign panel between those legs right up at the top and paint the logo on that along with the city of Ann Michigan. It'll all be flat, it'd be easier to read, and that should solve the problem. And if wind is an issue, there's perforated steel panels that they can put that on that will allow the wind to come through. So, you know, that might be another alternative to solving that issue.
I thought of that one.
I know it.
Hello, folks. Don Koschmider, Cadillac, Michigan. I'm just checking to see how long you guys plan on having a moratorium on any medical marijuana dispensaries in Cadillac. There's other cities that have dispensaries, provisioning centers, whatever you want to call them. There's a lot of people that have their medical marijuana cards and don't have a bunch of money to have a brand new car to drive all over Michigan to find safe access points, safe transfer points. The Michigan House just a couple months ago voted 95-11 to allow dispensaries and regulate them. It's in Senate right now, and it's going to be kicked out of committee tomorrow. You'll hear news from the Michigan legislature tomorrow. Everybody's happy, and they're going to vote on this. The Senate's going to vote, but we saw what happened last year with the lame duck session and the last-minute deal by the Michigan Sheriff's Association calling the Senate. But everybody's appeased. Deals have been made. I think we have a good bill, and hopefully the Senate will vote. But I'd like to see maybe someday dispensaries, so we don't have to drive all over Michigan. Medical marijuana isn't for everyone, but it does help. It does help some people. There's different cities like Gaylord that just took and went and did a petition drive. We went up there and helped them with that door to door. We went and got all the signatures, and the city manager stalled and did something, but we had a public hearing on it. The mayor said, hey, you get this by planning, I'm on board with it. Well, we had a final hearing, we put it in the paper, all those for or against, and it was a fantastic meeting at the Planning Commission in Gaylord there, and it got kicked back to City Council, and they're gonna vote pretty good things from Gaylord, but we'd like to see the city of Cadillac do this too. Like I said, it's not for everybody, but it does help some people. And not everybody can drive all around Michigan to find a safe transfer point. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, seeing no one else, we'll close public comment and move to good of the order. And we will start with Councilmember Spolman.
Thank you, Mayor. I had a Lake Mitchell Improvement Board meeting today, and I'm remembering that because it was today. Often I forget to report on them, but I do represent the city on the Lake Mitchell Improvement Board, which is established to control nuisance weeds for the most part in Lake Mitchell. And similar to what happens in Lake Cadillac, only they actually have a legal entity there called the Improvement Board, and there are representatives of the I believe there are two townships plus the city of Cadillac, and there's an appointment from the county there and two riparians. And we're looking at an additional assessment coming up, an assessment period. We're at the end of our current one, and so we made some decisions today. And it looks like we're going to recommend a four-year assessment for the next time. We've had three-year assessments in the past. But it looks like it's something that, you know, is going to be ongoing. You can't just treat for milfoil for a while and have it go away. You know, it's something that you continuously have to do. And we'll have a public hearing related to that and to the suggested amount up to on the assessment in March. I think that's all. I'm hoping that the city manager has an update to provide us about his request for a meeting with Bob Scarborough from Herring Township.
Okay.
Thank you.
Councilmember Shippers.
I don't have a lot. Haven't met with youth council since since I spoke with you, although please, if you are someone who is high school aged and would like to join us, we are still taking applications. And we would love to have more more young folks involved in the community that way. I'd also like to say happy Hanukkah to our friends and neighbors who celebrate that festival of lights, and remember that the possibility of miracle and miracles and peace and light in the world today is not something that goes without notice by me anyway. Also welcome Councilmember Keith, and that is all.
Thank you. Councilmember Stevens.
Mine's, I don't really have too much other than to again thank our staff for the Christmas holiday and the lighting and such that we have. The the last couple weeks going through other towns, and you start to realize those that are really into that. And I always think back to how ours looks in the park and along the lakefront area, and that's something that's commented on a lot. So just a little thank you to the council, to the staff as well for that. And I'm gonna, like, as they do, defer some of my minutes. I know next meeting's my last one, and we'll ask a little patience maybe for a little longer good of the order to thank people for the time I've served. So I'll cutting it very short tonight, hoping that you'll
give you extra minutes the next time.
Either that or give you a chance to leave first. I know sometimes you may want to do that first, but then I'll use my extra time from today then.
So we need a short agenda next time.
Okay, Councilmember Keith.
Well, I'm pretty new, so okay. I'd like to thank the council for selecting me to serve, and I hope my service will make you believe you did the right thing. And one other comment, you all know that I'm a retired FBI agent, and it does in a way have to do with our city. I think we need to always recognize the difficult job of our law enforcement people. And that that big incident out in California shows exactly how our law enforcement people act, how they serve. And there's been an awful lot of publicity about how bad law enforcement people can be. And not a terrible lot about how good they can be. And there were officers, sheriff's deputies, and others who put their life on the line to stop that terrible incident going on out there. I'm not sure that was the appropriate time to say this.
It was very appropriate.
But and so I think we've got to be aware of that. The other thing is, my wife has been saying for weeks, months, what could happen? This could happen here. And of course, I've been saying, why would they come here? Well, they came and did that in that little town in California. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't mean they couldn't do it here. Mm-hmm. So we got to be alert. That's good. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Marcus.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the council. This week I'm meeting with representatives from Herring Township along with staff to talk about whatever their planned project might be along 13th Street, and essentially to take input, information, and then bring it back accordingly. I haven't had the meeting yet, otherwise I would have shared what I had. A little bit of a PSA announcement, if I may. We have property, I should say, or we have the ability of trying to negotiate property for a developer or for somebody that is interested in property adjacent to the railroad. It's the former Mitchell Course site. It's important, I think, that we start to talk about it more positively publicly, of the opportunity that's out there. There's approximately 12 to 14 acres of land that's there. There are dollars available through the assistance with the MEDC to help clean it up, but what's needed is essentially a business plan. There has to be a bona fide a developer or property owner that's willing to come there and create jobs and put something on that site in order to, for us to then help that company or firm or individual get access to the capital that will then essentially clean the site up so that their plan can happen. Sounds a little complicated. That's probably because it is, but the reality is that the site's available and the city is more than willing to help broker these conversations. Call me. So that's my general PSA for the night on there. So
okay.
Thank you.
All right. Well, I have one thing this evening, and I want to give a shout out to the Cadillac Marching Vikings.
Oh yeah.
On Thanksgiving Eve and Thanksgiving Day, I had the opportunity to go to Detroit on the charter buses with our kids. And it was an incredible experience. And those kids, you would have been so proud of them. They marched and they played the entire 3 miles. And every time they did the party boy, the crowd went wild for the kids from Cadillac. And so it truly was a trip of a lifetime. And they represented this city so well at the hotel, with the chaperones, and downtown Detroit. And you would have been really, really proud of them. And I'm really proud of this community, because after the parade was over, we had the opportunity to participate in the Battle of the Bands. And those kids were there with 12 other bands. There were 13 total bands. And this community came together and voted. And it wasn't just the kids. It was all of the adults that I know in this community, outside of this community and out of state, that helped our kids win the Battle of the Bands for the Thanksgiving Day Parade this year. And that says huge things about our community. So thank you all. And with that.
Bravo.
Yes, bravo. Cadillac. With that, we'll adjourn the meeting.